Should he be on the screen right now?
Probably not. Hello, where is that red light?
There we go.
All right. Are we going?
I don't think so.
We should be. Where would it say that we're going or not?
I don't know. Did something happen when you closed it out?
Where is the... No, we're live, dude.
Oh!
We're live! Hey!
This is fun. I'm gonna pretend we're just two dudes talking the whole time.
This is, you know, when...
It wouldn't be the show without this, though, would it?
I just wanted to be super pro for Richard Fortus.
I'm always professional.
Man. So, hello, internet friends. I'm Ryan.
I'm Kai.
And this is Demos in the Dark, live. And
apparently so.
Tonight is an exciting one for us.
Yeah.
And I also had the stark reality hit me today that this could be the end of Demos in the Dark Live.
This could be it?
Well, I mean, if we blow this.
Oh, yeah. Well, then, yeah, it's
the
end.
If we blow this, we can't show our faces in this godforsaken town again.
In this godforsaken internet.
So I do want to get Richard on soon, because otherwise I'm just going to keep talking and nobody really wants to hear me. So,
let's do it.
Always longer than I think it's gonna be.
It, you know, you could make a shorter one.
I could make a shorter one.
You can make a longer one.
I could make a longer one.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so our guest this evening is Mr. Richard Fortus, who's played with everyone from Rihanna.
Yep.
And is currently
everyone from Rihanna.
From
no
Rihanna
two.
To the Guns and or Roses, who he is with right now. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further, where's my button?
It's on that screen. You're doing great.
Is it?
Yeah.
This double monitor thing kills me. Here we go. Mr. Richard Fortus.
Hello there.
You got us, Richard? Oh, no.
Uh-oh.
Richard, you got us? Hello?
Well, he looks fantastic.
He had us. Richard? This is... What do we do here?
Oh,
he's gone!
Goes.
That was it. That was it.
What
I hope
a
you
time.
I hope you enjoyed that. That was...
All the insights we could have ever wanted or ever needed.
Yeah, I think we got gossip, like celebrity gossip for days
yeah.
off of that.
Mm-hmm.
All right, wait a second.
At least we got to find out what's under Enrique's hat.
All right.
Should we try again?
Yes.
Hey, can you hear us?
Can you hear us now?
All right. I can
All
hear
right.
you. All right.
Perfect.
There we go.
We are on. So,
okay.
How are you, sir? How is St. Louis?
It's great. It's great. Not too cold.
Perfect.
Not too warm, but not too cold.
How's the family?
Good. Family's great.
Everybody's good?
Yeah.
Perfect. Did you have a good Thanksgiving?
Yeah, it was nice. It was quiet. It was just the four of us, my wife and my two daughters and I. So yeah, it was fun.
Beautiful.
I like small Thanksgiving.
Yeah. I have to imagine that, like, you know, after playing stadium after stadium after stadium, you know, it's got to be just kind of nice to only have
go to St. Louis.
Have three people sitting across from you rather than 30,000. So
we were just out for 3 months?
Yeah.
In the U.S.?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You didn't,
so, which was a very different type of touring.
Yeah. How is it different on the level that you're at? I mean, we can attest to bar band stuff, but mm-hmm. like, what is it, how is this different now for you?
Well, protocols, you know, it's just, we were very strict as far as, it's probably the same. All the crew wears masks all the time. We wear masks all the time. except for the time that we're on stage, you know. But where it really affects you is trying to get to your room, you know, and not wanting to get on an elevator with four other people that don't have masks on, you know. So you get off the elevator, you wait for, you know, it's that thing, you know, not being able to go to restaurants, indoor restaurants. We were avoiding that. So eating, you know, you eat in your room or you eat outdoors.
So you guys are you guys are one of the most dangerous rock bands of my childhood, being the adults in the, with the hotel elevator and all of that stuff.
Well, you know, it's this. I think what's different is, like, at home, I'm not that way at all. I'm not nearly that cautious. But the thing is that you're, you know, one person can take down the entire tour. And when you're traveling in a bus with, you know, a bunch of other people, you can take down the whole bus.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Because we don't wear masks in the bus, so.
Right. Wild.
It was very different. It
I
was very
bet.
different. No backstage guests,
Yeah.
no,
That
and that includes the llamas and the midgets and it, none of
Right,
that.
right. And the
So,
centaurs that are a combination of the two.
yeah,
Yeah.
no, none
Yeah.
of that.
That's a
So it
shame.
was a very different type of touring.
Before we go any further into this, I should acknowledge for anybody, I don't know that there would be anybody here watching this who doesn't know this, but we are talking about the band Guns N' Roses.
Yes.
Because right now, Mr. Richard Fortus is playing with the band Guns N' Roses. How long? It's been, what, 5 years? 6 years?
Coming up on 20 for me.
Oh, so you count the GNR years, but, right?
But how, that's how long I've been in Guns N' Roses
Okay. Isn't there,
for
wasn't there, like,
almost 20 years. Slash and Duff came back
right.
6 years ago. Six
That's,
years ago.
okay.
Yeah.
And
go ahead.
you got the call. This is fascinating to me, and I want to ask you a little bit, about this in a second here. From what I read, you got the call to come and join GNR while you were on tour with Enrique Iglesias. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. What have you recovered from that musical whiplash? And also, was that like an immediate get up and go thing, or did you have to like be hold off? I'm gonna visit or like finish my tour. And how does that happen, is my other question.
Yeah, I had actually been called before that to
Okay.
come and audition, maybe a year before or 2 years before, and I just got a call from the management. I was living in New York and they said, "Would you be interested?" And I'm like, "Yeah, sure." And I was going to be out in LA in a few weeks anyways to do an album. So we planned on doing it at that time. I was going to audition and I was going back and forth with management and talking about songs and they were sending stuff to me. And then I stopped hearing from them. I was getting on a plane to go out there to do this record and I hadn't heard from them. So I figured it just was not happening. I got to the session that I was doing, and on the session, the bass player and drummer were Tommy Stinson and Josh Freese.
There you go.
And so I said, who were in Guns N' Roses
Right,
at that
yeah.
time? So I was like, oh, this is crazy. I was supposed to come and audition for you guys. And they're like, oh, yeah, you're the guy from New York. I said, well, you know, we found this, Axel found this guy Buckethead and he called off all the auditions. So, okay. So Tommy and I coincidentally went out that night and became best buds. So ever since then we were like, you know, super tight.
Yeah.
And so next time they needed somebody, Tommy was like, hey, what about that? You know,
Yeah, cool.
so they called me. I had 3 days off. I was on tour. We played 3 nights at Royal Albert Hall, and then I had 3 days off, and so I jumped on a plane, straight off stage, got on a plane, flew to LA, did the audition, went back to the airport, got back on a plane, and finished the tour.
Oh my gosh. Yeah,
Yeah.
anybody who says that this isn't work,
Yeah.
like, it's just gotta, They got to hear stories like that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a kitty.
I don't.
Excuse me.
Two follow-up questions.
Pardon me.
Have you ever seen Buckethead without the bucket? Have you ever seen Enrique without the hat?
Back when I played with him, he didn't wear a hat.
Wow.
He had hair then.
Wow.
Yeah.
Good for him.
That was 2000.
Ah. By Lemos era. When, I don't know.
That's right. No, you're right. No, Hero. Hero.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Great song.
You know, we both do, you know, on a much smaller scale, where we both do the kind of for hire thing as yeah. well. I just looked up. And
yeah, I think you have something on your face.
And one of the things that I think is, and this is not a question, this is a more of a statement that I just feel like I need to get out of the way. One of the things that really impresses me about kind of looking over your whole career is that there are certainly like the session guys and for hire guys who or sidemen, whatever you want to call them, who really have their own style, and then they kind of go into all these different projects and kind of bring that with, and you know, maybe nudge it around a little bit, but you know, for the most part, you know, it's pretty recognizable. Think Stevie Ray Vaughan playing with David Bowie, you know. Mm-hmm. Like you're like, ah, know exactly who that is.
And Nile Rodgers. Yeah,
that was a cool track. Yeah. But one of the things I've noticed with you is that when you put on a different hat, per se, for a different project, like you change your mm-hmm. whole style of playing. And I have to ask, did you, like, you fit the role when you, you know, like, and did you, what was your musical upbringing? Did you go to music school? Did you, like, how did you kind of get into this spot where you can be this, like, chameleon, this, like, Tommy Tedesco chameleon type person?
I mean, I don't think that, I don't know, I never really thought about myself in that way. I mean, like, it's not like I'm changing my aesthetic, you know, this is my,
you're right.
But playing wise, I mean, you play for the song. And I think the thing is that I love so many different types of music mm-hmm. that it's, I always really enjoyed. I mean, that's what I loved about doing sessions in New York is that most, I'd probably say 80% of the things that I did were commercials or film score, TV stuff,
yeah.
you know? And so it's fun to do that, to yeah. be able to, like, it's like, wow, I get to play like a jazz player, you know? Yeah. I get to yeah. play like a country player, you know? But, you know, I love country guitar. I love, that sound, and I like, and I bring a lot of that into my rock playing, you yeah. know, but I think I just bring everything in and mix it all up.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And you know, like, you know, I've seen the current iteration of Guns N' Roses twice.
And, oh, is that right?
Yeah. And I know when, you know, they there are some solo sections where, you know, you and Slash go back and forth. And I remember this one particular night, you went first and you had kind of this big section. And I was listening to you go, like, you were grabbing stuff from all over the place and pulling it in. You were, you know, there was all this cool chromatic stuff. There were borrowed notes and all this, you know, like, you know, crazy stuff that you don't typically hear in a rock concert. And it was super cool. I remember just being like floored. I was just like, wow, this guy is amazing. And you know, like, I actually told this story to someone at NAMM when we were walking from our hotel, you know, in the morning. And I was telling this person how great of a player you were. And then we got to that long stoplight before you cross over and go into NAMM. And we realized that the person that we were walking behind the entire time was you.
That's funny.
That was and you know, and we talked about Tommy Stinson a little bit before we went on. We did a thing South by Southwest, and you you guys played, and you ended up playing on my amp, and that was cool. We have mutual friends with, like, Matthew Farrow from Alexander, Nick Greer, those guys and stuff. You and I have actually...
Right.
You and I have met at NAMM a couple of times, but I'm not terribly memorable. But...
you mentioned it, we can say it now. Yeah.
But...
Where did we meet?
I think we met at the Alexander booth.
Okay.
And then I think later... So my day job is I actually work for a distribution firm that represents both of those guys, and so that's why they're always kind of in that same row in NAMM,
right,
and then
right.
We kind of just hang out in that row too, so I think you just kind of showed up on Mass Distro Row and you're making the rounds and
Mass Distro Row. You're welcome.
That's my connection point right there.
That's neat.
That's all I got.
I have none.
But
are you sure we haven't met?
I don't know. I'm a little bit more memorable than Ryan, so yeah. You might be surprised.
But the in order to get you on the show, I called a friend over at Fender and told him that I wanted to talk to you about your new Gretsch guitars.
Yes.
And there are two. They're not just white and black. They're not just white and black. They are different. Different scales,
yes,
correct?
Yeah, that's right. One's 24.6 and one's 25.5.
Ooh, 24.6.
Yeah. How did you... I'm so curious. I was reading a little bit about them, and yeah, I'm just curious about the development process, and then you can probably sum it up in why 24.6, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, let's start there. How did you come to that scale length?
They do that scale length in some of their guitars. And then they also, like, all the classic Falcons are all 25.5.
Yeah.
Like, that's the classic Gretsch scale length. But they've done the more Gibson type of scale, you know, the 24.6 for a while.
I have I wonder what that scale is.
I don't know.
Which one? It's one of those player edition
jets. Yeah.
Is that?
Yes, probably. If it's a jet, yeah, probably.
So 24 points, is it really 24.6? That's a really specific number.
It's basically a Gibson
when you were setting out to design these, what were,
It wasn't really a setup. I just, you know, I was at NAMM and I was talking to Jason Barnes, and I was from Gretsch, and I was like, man, I wish you guys would do this. Why don't you make a guitar like this that is a double cutaway, that center block, that has, you know, and he said, well, that sounds like a signature model. And I said, okay, let's do it. If that's what it takes to get one.
Amazing. I'm going to try that.
Yeah, I could say that to Jason Barnes and he'd be like,
goodbye.
Who are you?
That's very cool. Yeah.
But I started playing the Players Edition Falcons when Slash and Duff came back in the band.
Was that to kind of like make up for the missing 175D? Or to pay homage to the 175D? Izzy played in the Appetite years? Was that big white?
Oh, right. He had one that was refinished white, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I...
No, so that wasn't... you weren't thinking about that at all.
You know, the thing... I love the way 175s look.
Yeah.
I love 175s. It's just... No, that would be... I wanted something to really support Slash's tone, because he has a very recognizable signature tone. So I wanted something that was really going to support and fit around, basically, you know, to interlock with his tone. And yeah, 175, it would be, like, I mean, I guess through the right amp, it would be cool, but
they're so thick. Yeah. They're like,
well, so is the Falcon though.
Yeah.
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 What
and that's not, it's, if there's two humbuckers, I mean, I tried a Tele, P90s didn't work at all. And I'm a big P90 fan, but yeah, it didn't work at all. Too much, the mid frequencies were fighting, you know?
So were
So
you
that.
thinking about Guns N' Roses when you were thinking about this particular signature model, or have you
Oh,
just fallen
absolutely.
in love
Yeah,
with the White
absolutely.
Falcon at this point? Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, because I wanted, I love Filtertrons, and it works so well in the band with Slash that, but I wanted something that I could play all night. So I didn't, so when I'm doing like what you were talking about, like the things where we'll trade back and forth, a lot of times I would play a different guitar because I wanted, because with the Falcons, with the Bigsby, if I'm doing a lot of bends and you know, it's easier to get around on a shorter scale, you know.
So
It's
is your shorter scale a hardtail?
yeah.
So that's your solo guitar.
Sort of, or anything that I'm doing more bends, or that, yeah, it's just it's fast, you know, it's faster. But so the black one has a stop tail and it's 24.6. And then the white one has the Bigsby, and it's funny because at first they put a
Did he freeze?
I think he's lost in thought.
I yeah.
Maybe he's asleep.
He's coming back?
He
He might.
He might. We're having some internet problems tonight.
Yeah.
The internet doesn't want us together with Richard Fortus.
Yeah. And we
We'll
thought
see if
internet were our friends.
we'll see if he pops back in. Hopefully he does. Super nice guy.
Very nice. I miss my white falcon. This is
This
doing
not
things to me.
helping you with your
No.
Here
Here he comes.
he comes. All right. Oh, now he's gone. Wham. All right.
We'll try. There he
There
goes. I like the drama.
you go. Yeah,
I
this is
live for it.
keeping
Hey
it real.
Why'd you guys hang up on me?
We didn't.
I was bored.
You were deep in one of these.
It was perfect. You were frozen like this for a while, so we didn't know if you were just dreaming.
I was pondering.
It was nice. It's like, yeah, he loves, he's just dreaming about it, playing his Gretsch. It's right there. He can just play his Gretsch.
What did he say? You know what? The next one that we have, so it's David Torn. When we have David Torn on, what we should do is we should do like fake freezing where we'll just be like.
You're ruining this. You're
The dog's
ruining
gonna get
this. You're
away.
ruining this.
Although knowing Torin, he'll be like, "Screw this,"
Yeah, I'm out. And then he'll hang up for real.
You guys are really interviewing Torn?
yeah, we
Yeah.
are.
I love David Torn.
It's me too.
Is there anything embarrassing we should ask him?
I don't know him.
Okay.
Oh.
I just know his playing.
Well, we'll
Yeah.
tell him you say hi. And
Please,
hopefully
I'm a big fan.
we
Which, by the
can
way,
make our first internet friendship.
Which, by the way, Craig Jarrett Johnson says hi.
Craig Jared Johnson.
This is going well.
He used to play with Joseph Arthur, the Jayhawks. But you have jammed with him before. Tommy brought you to jam with him at some point. Like you guys went to a show and you got up and played.
Okay, right.
I'm playing with him tomorrow night at Red Stag. I don't know any of the songs.
Oh,
At
right
Red
on.
Stag? That's
Yeah, send
fun.
my regards.
I
You know,
will.
there's a lot of time that I spent with Tommy that I don't remember.
And why would that be? Tommy's very responsible.
I bet you you're not the only
Yeah,
one.
that is probably true.
Yeah.
So the white one, we talked about the black one, the white one with the Bigsby on it, you're using that for more rhythm focused stuff.
Classic Gretsch stuff, where I would normally use the Gretsch, but but I can solo on it too. I mean, it's very, you know, it's still a double cutaway, and but I generally for songs that I want where intonation throughout the neck is important, more important to me, I'll use the longer scale for that. It's just sort of balancing, but between the two guitars, I can play them all night. So,
I wouldn't ask you to pick favorites amongst your children, but who's your favorite child? And then after that, which of the Gretches do you pick up more often? Like if you're just sitting at home, do you find yourself gravitating towards one?
No, I
Great.
don't. I mean, I'll pick up either one if I'm just sitting around. And if I'm recording, it really, it depends on the song.
What are besides the tailpiece and the scale length, are the pickups different as well, or did you keep
Pickups are the
those?
same.
Okay, cool.
Pickups are really what makes this guitar special, in my opinion. I mean, that's what really, there's no other guitar on the market like it because of the pickups.
Do they have, are they different from traditional Filtertrons?
Yeah, completely different.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's I was using in my Players Edition Falcons, the fully hollow ones, I was using an Arcane
Oh, nice.
Filtertron and love them. Fantastic. They work so well. So when we did this, got some Arcanes, we put them
Did
in,
you? Okay.
and it sounded like shit. I was like, I don't
Oh,
know what's
no.
going on. It was it, everything was different, and it turns out that the center block with a Filtertron really it's they're very much it changes the tonal characteristics completely. So we had to start at the back at the starting line again and come up with something completely different. What we ended up Gretsch was so incredible. They were incredibly patient with me through all my nitpickiness.
Good.
They actually had John Godesi from the Gretsch shop came out to our rehearsals with a winding machine. We had four prototypes, and he was winding pickups while we were in rehearsal. Because while we're in rehearsal, we're listening on in-ears. I've got my amps there. I'm listening on in-ears, and then our front of house guy is in a control room listening on reference monitors. So we're all like listening. Well, and going back and forth, and he's talking to us, and so he'd go, okay, I know. Let me try something, and he'd try it. Now it's still not there. The low end is not thumpy enough. Because you're listening under a microscope, with in-ears. I mean, it's brutal how,
I mean, it's
So,
fun to know that all of the Guns N' Roses people are as nerdy as we are when it comes to pickup stuff, too. That makes me really happy.
I cannot attest for all the Guns N' Roses.
I've seen some
I
interviews with
am
Slash about
nerdy.
his gear, and
Yeah,
it's not
whatever.
it, he doesn't he do,
No,
Slash, Gretsch hasn't
Slash
made
is
him a guitar yet.
Slash is very particular about what he likes,
Is he? Well, he likes
but
listen.
he is, but he's got his tone, but he's like he hit me to Brazilian fingerboards. He's like, it makes such a big difference in tone, and
Really?
I was like, bullshit, it's a fingerboard. I mean, how much difference can it make? Could it make? And he's right, it does. But yeah,
Really?
he's big about Brazilians and Brazilian
How?
fingerboards and his pickups. He uses the Duncan pickups on
Does
everything.
he ever like corner you in the bus and want to talk about dinosaurs?
We're not on the same bus.
I
They have
got
to separate us.
sure.
Yeah,
Okay,
too much dinosaur talk.
does he ever corner you in the green room
Yeah.
and want to talk about dinosaurs?
No, we don't talk about dinosaurs.
Really? You should talk to
No.
Slash about dinosaurs sometime.
We have, I mean, I know that he's, but I'll tell you what,
I am so
whenever I
out
have
of the loop on this, but I love the picture
All
you're
right,
painting for me.
whenever, okay, go ahead.
I we so one many years ago, a band was on tour and we had kind of just shared weird iPod situation whatever, and Slash was on an episode of the Nerdist podcast, and we were like, let's listen to that, and it was 90 minutes of him spitting out Latin words and stuff like that, talking about dinosaurs. He didn't talk about guitar
at all. I'm still picturing you on the same bus. I know that's not true, but like you're in your bunk, you're about to go to sleep, and you see a little top hat come up.
Do you know that? Do you know that dinosaurs used to have feathers?
Do you know
I believe it.
Do you know that Stegosauri and Tyrannosaurus Rex lived hundreds of thousands of years apart? Land Before Time is a lie. Okay, good night, Richard.
And he's still playing that original Les Paul. That's like broke the neck's broken in like seven places and stuff like that, right? So that's part of the sound. He's pretty particular.
I like that. That makes me happy.
I like it too.
And this brings.
It was funny. One time we were backstage and he had it on. He's like, "Hey, oh, today's your birthday?" I'm like, "Yeah." He's like, "Oh, happy birthday, man!" And he's like, "Here."
And you're like, "Oh," and he's like,
"So
no.
You have it with you, right?"
No. That's funny.
That's amazing.
I was amazed at the amount of gear that you had in your reverb sale. My question is, I had gone to Reverb once, and Turk took me down to the basement. And they were
Not Reverb. It wasn't Reverb. It was Chicago Music Exchange.
Okay. Similar across the street.
The umbrella.
Yeah.
Right. Used to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he took me down to the basement, and they were in the middle of like a Billy Corgan sale. And I know that Billy lives in Chicago, and like the amount of gear that was there that he was selling off. I'm like, where do you put all
where
of
was
this
stuff?
Before?
Yeah.
And then I was like, this is a massive collection to be unloading. And then I saw yours and I was like, what warehouse did you rent out for a while to keep all of that stuff in? I mean, like,
can we have the address?
Yeah. You seem to be, I've read interviews with you and seen interviews with you. I know that you are more knowledgeable about gear than we are. And has that just led to you just picking up stuff no matter, like, as you're going around the world and stuff like that and seeing something rare and buying it, or, like...
Yeah. I mean, I'm constantly on the hunt.
Sure. Yeah.
But, okay, so I had a lot of stuff, as you know, and I decided to... I don't use it all. I figured there's so many pieces that I had that I just didn't use.
Yeah.
You know, in my studio, I've got my favorite Tele, my favorite Strat, my favorite Junior, my favorite Gold Top, you know, my favorite 335, my Jazzmaster, you know, and I don't need six of them. I don't need six Jazzmasters. I never use my Jaguar. You know, all that. And I had even more amps. I mean.
Yeah. That was what I was most. I saw like the interview portion where you were kind of going through the amps. And I was just like, that's sick stuff. And I, you know, like I get the.
You should see what I kept.
We would like that. We'll drive. We'll start driving now.
Yeah. I get the amp. The amps, you know, like. The amp salivation thing happens for me a lot. And then I'll swear I need something, but then it's like, well, when am I getting out?
Well, what's interesting, and through doing the sale, I learned a lot. And that was one thing that really struck me is that people don't buy amps for the most part. People want guitars. People will buy, stores will sell 20 guitars to one amp.
Yeah.
To me, that's like insane because I mean, half your tone is your amp. Like, I change my amp as often as I change my guitar.
Yeah.
You know, it for a sound, you know, it's like, well, you get the idea, you hear a track and you're thinking, what do I hear? And you like, that's half the, half the equation.
Absolutely.
You know?
What are you, what are you touring with amp-wise right now?
Okay, well, in that sale, I sold that 7,300-watt Jose modded Marshall that I bought from Mick Mars.
Yeah.
A buddy of mine wanted me to ask you about that particular amp. He'll be sad to hear it went away.
It's a very famous amp. Yeah, it's a very famous amp. That was the first thing to sell.
Of course.
Yeah.
And I put it up for a crazy amount of what I thought was a crazy amount of money. And I was like, you know what? Because I have that amp cloned. I've had it cloned a few different times. Actually, Dave Friedman and I are working on a project now where he cloned it top to bottom, and we're thinking about he's going to release a limited run of those.
Cool.
Yeah,
If you can spare two.
but Trace from Voodoo Amps,
Yeah.
he did an amazing job cloning it, and he cloned another 73 from the same month to that one, and it's identical, and it actually sounds better. And so I kept that one.
Okay.
And then the amps that I'm using live are ones that Trace built. Originally, they were also clones of that amp, but then through the years morphed into something different. And I think they're great. They're
Yeah.
great amps. But that's what I'm using live, along with a Supro Black Magic.
Oh, cool. Are you
Yeah.
pretty hard on amps? Do you have a tech that's replacing tubes in between every show and stuff like
No, I'm
that?
not really tough on amps.
Are you tough on
I mean, we
guitars?
do. If
We
you ask
saw
my
that.
techs, some techs, yeah, would say, yeah, he's tough on them.
Okay.
I don't know. I think Slash is tougher on guitars than I am.
Yeah. He's a big guy.
Yeah.
He's a large man.
Well, he breaks strings. He has and you know he sweats a lot, you know, when he's playing. He's and I think he's got acidic sweat, and he'll break
I'm
strings
a
and
gross guitar player, I understand.
When you went to audition for them, when you flew across the globe to audition, was it one of those situations where, because I feel like if that that's one of the few opportunities that if it came up, unless it was something off of Chinese Democracy, if they were like, I'd be like, you don't even need to tell me what the songs are. I'll know them when I get there because I was a 13-year-old boy at one
stamped in
point.
my brain,
I
yeah.
mean, was it one of those situations where you were just like,
I didn't own a Guns N' Roses record.
Wow. Not even Appetite
I
for
love
Destruction.
that.
No.
Man.
Uh-uh.
What were you listening to?
So,
What were you listening to in 1987?
oh man, I was so into punk rock. I mean,
Okay.
that was my world. I mean, in 80, what, 4, 80, no, 82, I think. Yeah, somewhere around there, I heard The Clash, and everything changed, you know, at that point.
Yeah.
Because before that, I was listening to art rock, like Genesis and Yes and,
Yeah.
you know, Pink
We
Floyd and T-Rex and David Bowie and Humble Pie, and, you
Yeah,
know,
man.
it was like all older stuff. It
Yeah.
wasn't like the stuff that kids were listening to. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't Motley Crue, it wasn't
Right.
Poison,
Like
and then I got into the whole punk rock scene, you know, Black Flag and
Yeah.
Clash, and like from British punk to American punk, you know,
Yeah.
Circle Jerks and DOA, and yeah, and then the English, you know, the whole new wave thing, you know, with the Psychedelic Furs and
Yeah, man.
Echo and the Bunnymen, stuff like that.
You know who's one of those bands from that era that I think like should be considered one of the greatest bands of all time, but nobody knows who they are. Do you ever listen to Soft Boys?
Oh, he's still
He's
thinking
gone.
about it.
He's
He's thinking
gone.
again.
We'll never know. We'll never
Nope.
know what he thinks of the Soft Boys.
Yep.
Well, we'll see.
Wait, I'm here. I'm
Oh, you're
There he
here.
is.
Oh.
Oh. That was the ultimate psych out.
That was the ultimate psych out.
Yeah.
He said he's coming back.
I hope so.
So Nate, when you say the only band that matters, Are you talking about the Sopwiths?
I think he's talking about the Shags.
The Shags? Oh, man. Hold on. You're coming back.
There he is.
We can't...
Wait, who is the band?
Oh, Sopwiths.
Soft Boys. Oh my God, Robin Hitchcock. I did a record with Robin Hitchcock.
Shut up. Really?
But yeah, Underwater Moonlight is genius. It's, that entire record.
Oh my gosh, and the guitar work on that record is incredible. Insane.
Incredible.
Not to mention the bass playing and the drumming and the songwriting and the insanely strange lyrics. And yeah, I mean, just like that. That is one of those really incredible records. William Bennett says, "Did you just hang up on Guns N' Roses?"
Both of them.
So you were aware of, so did you chart on the plane?
Oh no, I was aware of them. Of course I was aware of them.
Well, yeah.
I mean,
if you're breathing,
and I
you're
liked
aware.
Them. I mean, I like, they did stand out to me.
Yeah.
From all the metal bands, you know, to me, I could tell they came from a different place, you know?
Yeah, I mean, so I, you know,
they came from the same stuff that I came from,
right?
You know,
yeah, exactly.
But that had to be a wild plane ride, trying to buy a record on the way to the store, or on the way to the plane store. Listen to me, I travel a lot. On the way to the airport, I think he's gone again. I can't tell anymore when you're just thinking.
All right,
that was pretty good. Did you have to chart stuff on the plane, or did you just show, like, I can't imagine showing up to a Guns N' Roses audition and being like, well, we'll just see what happens. But you and I are a little different in that you're actually good at guitar.
No, you know, I have the songs for like a week before.
Okay.
And
all right,
like, you know, a dozen songs, and
Dan,
including Chinese Democracy songs.
That's just not a record I know very much of. Not saying it's bad. Dan Crow wants to know if your punk roots influences your playing in GNR. Do you borrow from that punk stuff?
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's where that stuff comes from. I mean, that and the Stones. I mean, that and classic rock. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Fifth chords.
Very much so.
Yeah. What do you got?
Well, I was wondering, I was seeing if we had more rolling in, but for now, you started as a violin player, right? Is that true?
I did when I was, yeah.
Did you play for
very long?
I played
all through school.
Yeah.
Till college.
So you must have enjoyed it. What was it about guitar that, two questions in here, I guess I always have two questions. What was it about guitar that initially grabbed you, and then I assume you liked music enough to keep playing the violin if that had been your thing, but what was it about guitar that captured you and kept you there?
I was always, there were always guitars around my house because my father was a part owner of a company that made musical instruments.
Oh.
And
that we would know.
So I, St. Louis Music.
Okay.
Which made Crate and Ampeg and Alvarez and Electra.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those ones.
So there were always guitars around the house.
Yeah. So,
you know, and I was always really intimidated by them because they had really long necks and six strings. And I had my hands full with the violin, you know.
So when I, and this kind of comes
back. Are we still here?
Yeah, we're still here. When I started picking up guitar around 86, 87, and about that period of time, my dad was a player as well, and we always had Guitar Player magazine was always on the back of the toilet. But I remember, you know, starting to kind of feel around for, you know, what kind of guitar stylings I was into. And I do have this distinct memory of, like, looking at Slash and looking at CC DeVille and being like, I'm going to go with the Slash guy because that guy seems a lot cooler. Mm-hmm. And you're playing songs that were just a huge part of my my upbringing, and has just kind of, you know, really informed not my taste in music, but, you know, how I play music and stuff like that. And that's got to be just exciting as all get out.
Did I mention that I didn't have a Guns N' Roses record before?
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah. Did you have a Rihanna record before you?
That is
played
a great
with
question.
Rihanna?
No, I didn't. But I did have a lot of Thin Lizzy records.
Yeah. So
I joined Thin Lizzy.
So you took? Did you take over that gig from Vivian Campbell?
Yes. Yeah.
How cool is that? Yeah. I mean, like, Vivian Campbell's no slouch.
Vivian's so great. He's such a great player.
He is a great player. Is he a cool dude? He seems like a cool dude.
Yeah, yeah.
Is Mick Mars a cool dude?
He is. Yeah, Mick is sweet.
Ryan's just trying to find out who you hate.
I spent an afternoon with... I spent an afternoon with Mick at his house, and he was really very kind.
He's, when you sit down and learn that Motley Crue stuff, it took me a little while to figure it out, but like, it's all downstroke. Everything is downstroke. And at that point I gained this like crazy appreciation for Mick, because I couldn't play a lot of that stuff all downstroke like he did.
The Ramones are all downstroke.
Yeah, that's also true. So we are coming to the last 15 minutes. If anyone has questions for the last 15 minutes, we will take them. We have one here. Do you still have the Salvation Audio Tone Wheel Boost? And if you do, how are you using it?
Wait, do I still have what?
Salvation Audio Tone Wheel Boost. Is that something that's...
I'm not using it anymore. It's a cool, I mean, I still have them, and I still use them occasionally, but they're not in my live right now.
Do you?
Because of noise.
Noise. Okay. Do you do a big pedal board on tour, or just a couple of the basics and rely on the amp?
Everything's in a rack, and then I have a controller.
Okay.
Up front.
Is it a lot of stuff?
I am a pedal nerd.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's not a ton of stuff, but mainly what, to be honest, most of what I have to carry is to cover all the Chinese Democracy stuff.
Yeah. There is a lot of
stuff. You know, because the other stuff I could get by with a single channel amp and a cord.
Yeah. Exactly. And you got more dates coming out kind of on a rolling basis here.
Yeah.
You just got done with You just got done with 3 months around the U.S. And we were discussing a little bit, earlier, how, before we went live, like how the pandemic affected someone like you who makes your living, playing in front of people and lots of people. What was that like for you? I imagine you saw your wife and kids a lot more, which is great.
I know the pandemic was really difficult for a lot of my friends, and a lot of people struggled. But, and I feel sort of guilty saying this, but it was probably the best year of my life.
Hmm. Really?
Because since my daughters were born, I've never been home that much.
Yeah.
You know, for a full year, never. I've never been home. I'd never been home for a summer.
Wow.
Since they were born.
Yeah.
So it was incredible. It was great.
Yeah.
I worked every day. I was like, I was in my studio here. Like I had session stuff coming in, and you know, the first couple of months, nothing. It was like, you know, I was like, what am I going to do? And I started digging into learning orchestral software and,
like,
and scoring. Started getting into programming, orchestral programs like
Something beyond Native Instruments
called?
is my guess.
It's like no. Native Instruments is generally like a platform for
mm-hmm.
like all the Spitfire stuff.
Yeah.
All the Spitfire libraries, which are tremendous.
Yeah.
And so I started digging into those and learning and really learning how to control all the different articulations and, you know, how to map them out on my keyboard, how to use the assign different faders to be able to control the, yeah, that's really where the feel comes from with programming strings. And so I started doing that and doing all these different orchestrations. I did some stuff for the Mission UK. That really got me back into it and thinking, okay, this is something I've always wanted to have time to dig into deeper. And so that's what I did. That's been great. But then I was then started after a few months, session stuff started pouring in.
Yep.
And then I was able to, you know, I was working doing, and I love doing that. I love working on completely different projects, you know?
Yeah. And you know, that kind of goes back to what we were talking about at the beginning, where you do have this really great kind of jack of all trades, you know, approach to playing guitar, which I think is amazing.
I did these classical pieces for a video game, you know, where I was doing all this nylon stuff, and I had to really sort of brush up on my nylon shots, you know, my classical guitar stuff, because I hadn't done it for a while. So yeah, that was a lot of fun. I love doing different, like completely different types of music. So
yeah.
Much fun.
You know, one thing that he and I noticed this with Brian Fallon from Gaslight Anthem when we had him on the show, and I think it might just be a thing that successful musicians might do,
mm-hmm.
where it's like you will never stop learning and trying new things. Like you are just constantly like a student of music, and that's, if I'm putting words in your
mm-hmm.
mouth, let me know.
No, it's absolutely true.
Yeah, and I think that's absolutely, absolutely amazing. I have some of that, but it's kind of like, oh, I wonder if I can learn that solo. You know, like, it's not like.
Do you learn solos, or do you sit down and think, like, where, and look at the, like, analyze
mm-hmm.
it? And...
I did go to school for composition. So I typically what I look at is like, how did they get to there? I think that's cool.
Right.
What was the thought process that brought them there? You know, whether that is, you know, usually it's really boring, like pulling apart like the theory of it and, you know, kind of going like, oh, so there you went, Lydian, and you know.
Right,
like,
right. Yeah, but that's not boring. I mean, that's what we do. That's
right.
Like.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, that's what's fascinating about music.
Dan Crow says you would be the most badass musician in the St. Louis Symphony Orchestra.
I would love that.
You know, I did play with the St. Louis Symphony Youth Orchestra.
That is
almost
awesome.
Dan Crow again would like to know, if you weren't in GNR, what supergroup would you want to join?
Supergroup.
I think it's just like, who among your friends would you want to be in a band
with?
And that's pretty much
band.
A super group. Yeah. Is there a band
you
always
what?
Wanted to play
I actually, with? I actually had that opportunity when I, with the Dead Daisies, to put together a super group of all my friends that, you know, it was a really cool experience. So
that's very awesome.
So that's actually that first. Okay. So this was, that band was originally Charlie Drayton playing drums,
yeah,
who is like, there are no better drummers than Charlie Drayton. He's just, he's an amazing musician. And Daryl Jones is playing bass.
That'll work.
And Dizzy came in, was playing keyboards. I mean, it was like, that was a great band. That was a lot of fun.
That's super cool. Now, since St. Louis came up again, you were raised in St. Louis, right?
Yes.
And then you went to New York and you traveled the world and you saw
I lived in New York most of my life. I mean,
okay.
I lived in New York for 20-something years, you know, and then I lived for a few years in L.A., and I still spend a lot of time in LA, but and then I moved back to St. Louis.
And what is it about St. Louis that you love that brought you back there?
Well, he's got a house.
Yeah.
Well, I good. Before I had a house here, I wanted. I actually bought the house that I grew up in because I wanted. It came up for sale,
cool.
And my father was sick, and I wanted somewhere to be able to come and see, visit him, and bring my family, and yeah. So, and then I ended up, I bought the house, we fixed it up, and then we ended up staying here.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's awesome. That's a great story.
Because I didn't really need to be. Everything I was doing was via the internet, so. You know, and when we do rehearsals, I go out and do rehearsals.
Sure, yeah. You just fly out to rehearsals.
Yeah, and it's probably nice to retreat to Kansas City after.
Yeah, I mean,
like, I would never go to Kansas City, but.
Yeah, oh, you go to St. Louis.
St. But Louis. Yeah, St. Louis yeah. is great.
I wouldn't either.
I was thinking
I was thinking in my head, don't say Kansas City. That's a terrible place. And then there I went.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was thinking like Dave Chappelle living in a tiny town in Ohio.
Yeah.
You know, like.
Yeah.
You know, people are like, why is Dave Chappelle living in a tiny town in Ohio? I was like, why not?
Sounds kind of nice.
Yeah.
Don't get hassled at all. People, you know, it's, yeah, it's cool.
They're like, oh, there's that long-haired leather jacket guy who's always getting on our case about wearing masks.
Yeah.
That's always walking his kids to school.
Yeah. Jerk.
There's his wife walking her dogs without him again so he can be on the internet with idiots.
Man, you know what? We are on the closer.
Are we on the closer?
We're on the closer.
Wait, that's it?
That's it.
We can keep going if you want, I guess. I don't think we got a good look at the Gretches. I would like to.
Yeah, let's do that one more time. Let's full screen you. Let's look at these Gretches. Because that's. Yeah.
Look at that.
Man.
Man. That.
I love the tortoise.
Yeah. William Bennett. The lighting's not that good. But the tortoise binding on the black and on, like, you can't, you're never going to be able to see it. But it looks so good. It's just so much more classy looking than the sparkle gold. Yeah. I don't know.
I just had a guitar made with the sparkle gold, but I'll let it slide. yeah. I'm a huge.
Did you? What'd you have?
I'm a huge white falcon fan. I played one of the players' falcons for a while, and then I crashed my car and had to sell it to buy it, put some money towards a new car. So then our friends, the Frank Brothers, who are a Toronto-based guitar company, and I designed a guitar with their body shape, but it's all based on falcon stuff. I did put humbuckers in it. Please don't tell Gretsch. But yeah, it's got all the like. Gold sparkle binding all the way around and all that stuff. So
I mean, like the emblem on the pickguard, since they're Canadian.
Okay,
so it's a goose.
I have my geese right here, so we did a little goose etching.
It's pretty cute.
Yeah,
nice.
But yeah. Now so, I need one with tortoise.
Now you do.
Yeah.
Man, you ought to check out these. Well, I guess we're not going to be selling these pickups separately, but these pickups are so unique.
They're I'll just have to pick up one of your guitars. I'm fine with that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's very much it's a hybrid between a PAF, like a vintage PAF, and a vintage Filtertron.
Cool.
That is amazing.
In construction as well as in tone.
Oh.
It's very much a hybrid.
That's very cool.
I think.
Yeah, nobody's done anything like this, really.
Wow.
I think Shaw designed the pickups that are in the only Gretsch I own.
Yeah.
Tim Shaw makes great stuff.
Yeah, I mean, he's, really you know, he's like, he's a household name for a reason. All right, we got one more question, and then we'll close it. What vintage spec Gretsch guitar do you prefer?
Okay, so when I did my sale, we didn't really talk about this, but I actually would, I would line up all my Gretches, and I would sit and listen back and forth to each one. And I had 358s. Now 58, because that was the first year of the Filtertron. It doesn't say patent applied for on it. And there's just blank. They're blank pickups. And supposedly, like, that's the year, right, for for filtertrons. So I had three from 58. I had a 6122, a 6119, and a 6120. And I would think that the 6119, the single pickup, would be the best sounding one, but it wasn't. And 6122 was like their top of the line. In fact, mine was six serial numbers away from Chet's original number one. Yeah.
Holy smokes.
And it was beautiful, absolutely beautiful. But and I bought it from the original owner, and but the 6120 sounded better.
All right.
So that's what I have. I have a 58 6120, and then I have 57 Duojet.
Cool.
Those will be fine. Those will do.
Those will do the trick.
Well, it has the Dynasonics, which is why. Right. You know, so I have one with Dynasonics and one with Tones. Yeah.
I want to go hang out at your house sometime.
Yeah.
Or your warehouse where you have all of this.
All that stuff that I sold, I reinvested in.
I bet you did.
I just bought really. I just, but my warehouse is much smaller now.
Yeah, but it's got it's got a burst in it.
It does have a burst in it. So also got a, it also has a 58 335 in natural.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's one of my.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got some great stuff.
Do you get
stuff.
Scared great. Looking at them? I would get scared.
I have a. Yeah, yeah. I have a really big safe.
Yeah.
the kids have never seen those
and
guitars.
I'm picturing you playing them in like elbow-length white gloves.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It. I'll be honest, it did take some getting used to.
Yeah.
I bet.
To be able to pick up the burst and use it.
Yeah. I only played one. I played one once in a shop, and it was the one in Nashville.
Carter.
Yeah, Carter Vintage. Mm-hmm. I think it was a 60, not a 59. But as I was playing it, Sayer, a mutual friend, he leaned over to me and just said, "If you wreck that guitar, even if you sold your house, you couldn't pay for it." And I was like, "Take it back."
Yep.
Mm-hmm. You know, like there's a story about a guy going to the Dallas guitar show in like the late 90s early 2000s, and he had like five or six of them, and he wanted like $10,000
total.
No, for each. He wanted $10,000 for these bursts, and I guess all of those vintage guitar dealers at the time were like, "Get out of here." So he left.
Sure.
He left with all of those bursts. Yeah. And then here we are. They could have
he did fine. He did fine.
Yeah, I'm sure he did.
I hope he's happy wherever he is.
And that guy was Bill Bonamassa. Richard, dude, this has been incredible. I know that you're a super busy dude, and I appreciate you taking the time out to do this. And
you should thank my wife for walking the dog.
I will.
By yourself.
I will. I will.
I will.
I will call her.
I will. When we visit and try out all of your guitars, we'll make sure to do that.
You're welcome anytime. I have a place for you guys to stay.
Oh my goodness, that would be a dream. So nice to meet you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
My pleasure.
Awesome.
Thanks, you guys. I really appreciate you having me on.
Good luck on tour. Next time you come to Minneapolis, know that we will be somewhere in that sea of people.
Yeah, and if you ever need a sub, just call Ryan.
I'll be right there.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you guys.
All right, thank you. Congratulations on the guitars and everything, man.
Yeah.
All right, thanks. All right, talk to you soon.
We just talked to Richard Fortus!
What a cool guy! He just said we could stay in his house.
And he was lying.
I know, but we have it. We have it digitally preserved.
Oh my God!
It would hold up in a court of law.
Starkey, you slept through that whole Leo.
Yeah, whoever you are.
Yeah, my gosh.
My favorite was Fortus was talking, and Leo was just snoring his little cute ass off.
Wow. I think we can do David Torn next.
Okay.
I think we got it.
Okay. I still didn't find out what's under Enrique's hat.
No.
Like, if he takes his hat off, does his whole head fall apart? I don't know. We don't know. Yeah.
Wasn't it like that was a thing from like the Hellraiser movies, right? where like they had that like, never mind, whatever.
I don't know. I just remember a really scary story in a book my parents gave me when I was far too young about a woman who wore a scarf and then she took it off and her head fell off. Oh, I hope that doesn't happen to Enrique.
I remember that story too. That's that.
I hope he's okay.
Man,
Enrique, if you're watching, post in the comments. I need to know your brain is still in your head.
And you're welcome to come on the show anytime.
I would love
Enrique
that.
Iglesias.
Yeah.
We can be your hero, baby.
Yep.
So hey, thank you for those of you who checked us out for the first time because you were going to see Mr. Fortus.
Mm-hmm.
We hope you stick around. We do a lot of gear demos and stuff like that here, and we also do more of these live shows. And our next one is
David.
Two weeks from now.
In two weeks.
It will be David Torn. Then we close out the year. And Robert will, it'll be up tonight for the whole thing, and mm-hmm. then the rebroadcast will be easier to find tomorrow after YouTube scrubs it. But we did it. We came out alive.
We did it.
And we couldn't have picked a nicer dude. He was great.
He's a sweet man.
And he's, yeah. So, right. Thank you, everyone here, for your time. And we will see you guys in 2 weeks.
Oh, I didn't do the leg wrap last time. All right. There we go.
Now
we'll see ya.
Bye.